Ayushman Bharat as a concept, as an idea, as a principle, I think is a very big requirement in India, where citizens who were below the poverty line had no access or very limited access to healthcare or good quality healthcare all across the country. Theoretically, this idea is a must in our country, where every patient and every consumer should have a right to at least a basic level of healthcare. Having said that, I think there are certain things that we must be cautious about as we roll out Ayushman Bharat all across the country. What we must remember is that the private players in India are not all of the consistent quality. There are private players who follow great quality, and there are private players who don't follow good quality. And we must be careful in recruiting the right quality of players as part of Ayushman Bharat. We must be careful in making sure that frauds and leakages are limited to the minimum. And most importantly, that the quality of firms that are enrolled and empaneled in Ayushman Bharat are given the right processes and system and monitored and regulated, that the patient is finally actually truly getting a better quality of healthcare compared to what they were getting in the public system earlier. This is very doable, very possible, but I think it requires us to really lay a framework of process and systems now, rather than focusing too much on the ramp up of Ayushman Bharat, because I think the pillars, the very solid foundation needs to be built at this point of time, rather than focusing too much on really ramping up in terms of the number of patients, the number of hospitals, and using technology to be able to really manage some of these processes today. I fully support the Ayushman Bharat team led by Dr. Indu Bhushan, as well as the PM and the health minister and all their vision and ideas of doing this. And of course, Metropolis, as always, is very happy to continue to support Ayushman Bharat in any way possible to be able to make this a reality for all citizens of India with good health. So as I've seen diagnostics evolve for the last 18 to 19 years, it's been very interesting. I mean, 18 years ago, there was no diagnostics industry at all. I remember we were the first ones to really start building a chain of labs. And there was no industry. Everybody was an individual, single laboratory owner, either run by a pathologist or run by a technician. 20 years ago, we all hoped that the government would come in and put regulation and reform the industry to make it at least have minimum standards, to put a basic level of quality that you need to operate in the business of lives, of life and death for patients. Unfortunately, that has not happened. But what we have seen, at least in the last 15 to 18 months, not the last 18 years, is that the government is showing intent to put minimum standards and regulate the industry. I really hope that going forward in the near future, we will see this reform and regulation actually get implemented and be effective across states, across the country. The biggest challenge that is there today because of this lack of regulation is the fact that we have oversupply in the industry, because anybody and everybody can start a pathology lab or an imaging center without any consequences. This leads to a serious deficit of accountability towards the patient and towards the doctor, because anybody can get in, there is no barrier to entry, and once they get in, they have the ability to operate in any fashion they want, with good quality or no quality, keep any prices linked to the poor quality also, and provide poor services, which leads to the general erosion of quality in the industry and gives a bad name to the industry in total. I genuinely hope, for the sake of the lives of patients in India, that we're able to change this in the next many years to come. I think the second challenge that I think the industry really faces is that because there is no recognition either amongst the consumer of the differentiation between a good quality pathology laboratory and a not so good quality pathology laboratory, and because of the lack of government regulation, you see patients getting taken for a ride. Patients land up having to do tests multiple times because the doctor will not accept the report when often they get it done from a poor quality lab, which means there's a lot of leakage and wastage of patient money. And that also means that there's a lot of leakage in the industry. Again, this leads to a bad reputation of the industry, and it doesn't allow for the industry to grow in a healthy manner. I think some of the other challenges are linked to the supply side, on the talent side. The number of doctors that are actually generated, pathologists or radiologists that are actually generated in the Indian states in terms of number of seats are very limited. As we know, the medical education system is quite broken and needs to be fixed. And therefore, the number of talented doctors that come out who are actually with practical knowledge are very few. And therefore, we see, again, a lack of talent leading to a lack of capacity building, which leads to a lack of growth. Even though we have such a large country with so many people that need to be taken care of, it is this lack of capacity building because of talent that we're not able to really access and reach and provide services to people all across the country. I hope some of these challenges get fixed in the next years to come. But I also know that along with these challenges, there will be a fresh crop of challenges that will come about, as we are seeing today, with a lot of online e-commerce companies that have started in healthcare, again, not mandated with quality at all, and therefore disrupting the industry, unfortunately, not always in a positive manner, and often with negative consequences for the patients. And I really hope that today, as leaders, all of us can get together and try to bring a betterment in terms of quality in the industry. So as I've seen Metropolis evolve over the last 18 to 19 years, you know, we started from a single pathology laboratory, one location in Bombay, with a small B2C presence. And we've now grown to about 125 labs with 2,600 centers across five countries in the emerging market space. This evolution and this rise and this growth, we're all very proud of. But I think there's nothing that I'm more proud of than the fact that we've built an extremely respectable name in the industry, where people consider us to have the best quality, the most personalized services, the largest test menu, and really a genuine empathy for the patient. To me, this culture and this DNA of Metropolis is the most valuable asset that we've actually built in the company. Numbers will come and go, financials will rise and decrease, valuations will increase and fall the next day. But the core goodness in an organization is not easy to change or not easy to dilute. And I think that's what we've been really trying to build with Metropolis. From a customer standpoint or from a doctor standpoint, the way that they experience this with Metropolis is they see a genuine warmth and a genuine integrity in the way we deal with them. We're not known to be people who will lie or take shortcuts to get out of our responsibility and accountability. We're known to be fair to not only our investors, but to our customers, and therefore be extremely balanced and sustainable about the way we are building this business. I think people see that all represented not only in the way we take care of our patients, but like I said, with all our investors and our relationships with all other stakeholders, where people have seen this experience with us at every step along the way. I think today Metropolis's biggest USP is that while we are very intent on building a sustainable, profitable, good quality franchise in, you know, today and in the long term, we also have the ability to take risk. We also have the ability to think forward strategically, take risk where necessary, cautiously but optimistically, and to be able to really build out this business in healthcare over the next many years to come. And I think our biggest USP is going to be the fact that we're very open to ideas, we're willing to adapt, and we're willing to use technology to the best of our abilities to be able to constantly change ourselves, as the evolution of healthcare moves on. I'm very excited not only about where we are today, how far we've come, but really with our plans for the future and the quality of the team that we have that really is behind driving all of it. I believe there's a lot more possible in the future, and this is just the beginning of the diagnostics industry and just the beginning of the Metropolis journey. And I'll be very happy to see all of you share this with us in the years to come. I've now been in healthcare for the last 18 to 19 years of my life. So I've seen the industry evolve as India has evolved. I've seen the consumer's aspiration change. I've seen the way doctors operate change. I've seen the way hospitals have come up and how government is now looking to partner with private industry. There has been many stages of evolution in healthcare in the past 19 years, but I don't believe there has ever been as much change in healthcare in the last 19 years as we are going to see in the next 10 to 15 years of healthcare. We're at a very important fork in healthcare where the past and the future are sort of merging, but the characteristics of companies and healthcare businesses that are going to be successful in the next 10 to 20 years are going to be very different from the companies that actually succeeded in the past 20 years. What are some of those things that I believe are going to be very relevant? Healthcare, if I just compare quickly, in the past 20 years, has been a lot about doctors who have had the ambition and the technical and commercial abilities to be able to balance both and be able to lead from the front from a perspective of science, expertise, but also commerce and business. We have seen those doctors go on to build hospitals, to build chains of labs, to build all kinds of primary care and other daycare, And today, these are the doctors that we celebrate, and non-doctors that we celebrate in our healthcare industry today. But as technology is changing, we're seeing a different world where the consumer is going to not make decisions purely on the basis of a doctor's name anymore. Convenience, data, data privacy, data migration, billing abilities, standardization, quality, relationships with insurance companies are all going to become very important factors in the next 10 to 20 years of healthcare as we move forward. Not all the companies who've been successful in the last 20 will continue to be successful in the next 20, and there'll be a whole new generation of new startups and technology-driven startups which will come up, which will actually disrupt the industry and take over some of the brick-and-mortar businesses that have been built so far. So how do entrepreneurs really continue to be resilient, continue to survive, and continue to adapt, to really adapt to this new market as we move forward? I believe an open mind of what can work in healthcare is very essential as part of this. I see a lot of healthcare conferences and events where people say, oh, I know how healthcare works. That's not possible, and that's not possible. And I think keeping an open mind to see how we can adapt ourselves before somebody else disrupts us, I think is going to be a very critical part. And I think that's where an open mind, be it from the youth or be it from an older person, will be very critical. I think the second part of it is going to be a comfort with technology, a comfort to be able to move old ways of working, old ways of building relationships to a very different technology-based enablement of processes. Again, it's going to be the people who are able to adapt to technology and use it to the maximum to the maximum ability are going to be the real people who survive in the future. Number three, I think companies, whether they were in healthcare or outside healthcare, who decided to get into healthcare with the mindset of saying, oh, this is a gold rush and there's a lot of opportunity and I can build something, but who didn't really focus on the science, the credibility, the trust and the quality aspects of the business, I believe we will see dying out in the next few years. Because this industry is one which is so dependent on quality and scientific expertise, all about the stamp of credibility, that unless you really nurture that talent, and unless you really nurture that ability and culture in the healthcare organization, just a pure commercial organization in healthcare will not succeed as we go forward. People who are willing to take the time to really build detailed processes and nurture that are going to be the winners and the survivors in the next 10 years to come. I think these are some of the characteristics that I've mentioned, not all, but I'm really excited about the next 10 to 20 years of healthcare to see how India changes, our industry changes, and leaders change in this next evolution and change phase of growth.